Bob, let me pick up with you, and I want to make sure that as our listeners are listening to us, I mean, we're talking about the thing called a gun right now, but we're talking about the loss of life and what we should do about it. Bob, this morning we had a number of pastors that were part of a conversation with the Pastors Network, and we were trying to find out what they were doing in their churches, how they were responding to this, and they had that kind of compassion that you had. But I know in this church in Texas, we don't know whether anybody had anything on them, any weapons or not. We don't know whether if they had it, they weren't able to draw, they were pinned down, however that would be. But I know one pastor this morning who made a comment who said that many people in his church, particularly the older folks, never felt that it was right to even have a gun. They didn't have faith if they considered such a thing because the doors must always be opened. And so people are wrestling with this kind of thing. How do you wrestle with that aspect of it's a church and a gun? Would we imagine having that that could kill somebody? Put that in perspective here for us right now.
Yes, I'd love to do that. If I can first respond directly to pastors that wrestle with this issue, because it starts with them. Until they're comfortable and they have a piece about a security program, they're not going to have one. And so I want to offer some comfort to them that may be listening. I want to remind them that in the Old Testament, when the tabernacle and the place of worship was there, this was God's business. They would have porters who would watch the doors, who would guard the doors. They would even have watchmen on the wall who would announce the stranger that was coming. Nothing unusual. The church actually got away from that as we know it today. And I want to say that even in the book of Revelation chapter 2, when you go look at the very first church that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ writes, tells John to write to at Ephesus, he's praising them because they're standing against evil and they're vetting those that are coming in under false pretense, false apostles, the whole nine yards there. He's praising them for that. And then when you get into that fourth church at Thyatira, he's praising them. But what he's not praising them for is the evil has come in because they're letting it in. And Christ is holding them responsible for that to the extent that he says that he would remove their candlestick. So I know it's within our Savior's will that we as under-shepherds that oversee the flocks that he's appointed us over, he has put us in a position to lead them, to feed them, but also to protect them to the best of the abilities that he affords us to have. And that's what we need to understand, that if we're going to preach the Word of God, and we believe this, we have to realize that evil is not a symptom. Evil is a disease. What this man did in Texas is a symptom of that disease. I don't like chasing emotional bones. I'm more of a factual kind of guy. When I say that the evil act is a symptom, this man shooting and killing those innocent people in a soft target with no defense, that is pure evil. I agree with that. But the evil existed before he executed that evil wrath. That was a symptom of the evil. We have to realize that it's out here. It's not just realizing it when it's too late and it's manifested itself. You know, my fellowship with my church family, we can sit down in our fellowship and we can break bread and have meals together, and they have spoons and forks and knives, and you know, nobody kills each other with them. You go into a prison and they'll stab you to death with a spoon. What's the difference? Is it the spoon and the fork? It is not. The difference is the evil that exists there. I go outside today where I'm at. It's kind of cold. I'm not real fond of the cold, gentlemen, but that cold is an absence of heat. We as pastors need to realize what godlessness really is. I don't expect the world. I don't expect the politicians. I don't expect the left, the right, the middle, the fence riders, for that matter, to understand that. My Bible tells me that the god of this world, small g in 2 Corinthians 4:4, has blinded the minds of those who are without the glorious light of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Simply meaning this, they have no spiritual discernment. We can't chase this emotionally. We have to look at it factually, and the facts that God gives us through his word is how we must look at that.
You know, that is absolutely true, Bob, and I appreciate you sharing that. I mean, that was a good dissertation that you gave there. And this is one of the things that has been coming to my mind more and more recently, but particularly even since Sunday. As pastors, we also need to up the ante, as it were, on evangelism. I've often said that, if that shooter knew Christ, then that undoubtedly would not have happened on Sunday. And that's one of the lessons that I think we as pastors need to learn. Not only are we to be protecting our flock, as we're talking here, from physical harm when we can do it, but we also need to lead our congregations to become more evangelistic in ministry.